Diversity, the wider vision on BCTV, is supported by Berks Community Action Program.
Welcome to Diversity and the Wider Vision. I'm Joseph Amprey, and thank you for joining us. This is a very important program. Today, we're going to talk about what I call sexual minorities, a part of our community who are very important, but who have been neglected and in some cases abused, the LGBT community, the gay community. I have three experts who will give you some phenomenal information about this subject. My first guest is Shannon Hoehne. Shannon, thank you for coming. He's a graduate student at Kutztown. Thank you for coming, Shannon.
Thank you for having me.
My second guest is Dr. Deborah Sieger, who is Professor Emeritus at Kutztown University. Deb, thanks for coming.
My pleasure.
And my final guest is James Wilkie, the Counseling Director at the Greater Reading LGBT Community. Mr. Wilkie, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
I'm first going to talk a little bit with Shannon Hoehne. I met Shannon when he was an undergraduate student at Moonbury College, where I taught part-time. He was an excellent student, and I knew him also as a man who did work with dogs. He's a former 9-year service member of the United States Navy. He's had some phenomenal experiences, and he's overcome them. Shannon, tell us about some of your experiences as a gay male.
Oh, boy. Where do I start? I guess properly I would start when I was probably younger. I came out to my father at the age of 15, and when that occurred, I became homeless like most of the LGBTQ community has experienced. After that, I found my way and I kind of like joined the military. I served during Don't Ask, Don't Tell. During that, there was an incident which required me to report it. I was raped, and I actually woke up in hospital because they had me in a medically induced coma. So as I reported it, the MPs took it and gave me a dishonorable discharge for homosexual conduct. Since then, I have fought it with the help of disabled American veterans, and it's now moved to an honorable discharge, which affords me to go to school and get the mental health services that I need. Right now, I'm a graduate student at Kutztown University of Pennsylvania for addictions counseling. And just chugging along.
I have really admired the strength you've shown, the resilience you've shown, and how you've overcome. You got your honorable discharge. You have completed a bachelor's degree. You're now doing a master's degree. Yep. You're going to work with addictions counseling. You've also worked with animals. You've been a person who rescued the huskies at one time, and now you're working with horses. And I guess I see you as a man who has overcome so much, and you've done it so well. I'm proud of you. What advice would you offer to people who are gay, who are being kicked out of their homes or just abused just because they have a style that they did not choose, but which they, and you come out, which is wonderful. Give us some inspiration for other gay men, if you would, please.
Of course. I mean, you don't know where your rock bottom is. Everybody says you have to wait till you hit rock bottom. We don't really know where it is until you actually hit it. And, I went through 7 years of heroin addiction until I hit my rock bottom. And that was between getting out of the military and getting the honorable discharge. And the best thing I can say is there's hope out there. You're not alone. You can always find it by just Google searching, LGBT community services in my community, or, go to an education center like Muhlenberg College, where I attended, and I, found you, Mr. Amprey. There's never really any time that you need to be alone. There really isn't. There's always help out there. You just have to ask. And I'm sure the other panelists are going to offer great resources.
I want to say this with emphasis. I didn't choose to be straight. And Shannon didn't choose to be gay. And so the LGBT community are people who have a gender which they didn't choose. And we should not be punished for choices we don't make. We need to honor all people and respect all people. And that's one of the things why we're doing this program. We hope that those listening who are gay can get inspiration. We hope those who are wondering how you can help, you can be an ally. You can support your family and your friends because they need support. And one inspiration I got once, I had Shannon on the show once, and a lady came who he said was a mother he didn't have. This was a lady who reached out to you, and that really gave me inspiration.
Tony Wellington.
Are you still connected?
Yes, we are still tighter than ever.
Yeah, well, that's what we need more of. I'm going to come back to you, but I want to go now to Dr. Deborah Sieger, who I've known for about 35 years. She's a former nurse. She's a former president of the Pennsylvania chapter of the National Organization of Women. And she has always been a strong supporter of all students and all, not only minorities, but gay and people who have been abused. I really admire the strength she's always shown. And I would never have thought that she ever encountered any challenge because she always seemed very strong to me. Deborah, thank you for coming on. Tell us about some of your journey, if you would, please, and some of the things you're doing.
Mm-hmm. Well, thanks. I started knowing I was different from other people when I was probably 7 or 8 and couldn't put a label on it until probably my first year in graduate school. My evolution was a long one, not terribly torturous, though I remember my dad saying when I was 22 that 22 was a good age to get married. And then I was 21 and a half, and he said, well, 24 is a good age to get married. And I got to be 23 and a half, and he said, well, 26 isn't a bad time to get married. And finally, we had the conversation about the fact that I was not going to get married in the traditional sense. And I have to say that I had just left an attorney's office. I had rewritten my will, and I was on my way home. And I'll never forget, I was just about off of Lancaster Avenue getting on the bypass in Reading when the Supreme Court decision came down about gay marriage. And I literally had to drive off the side of the road and park and just sit and think about what that meant to hundreds of thousands of people. And here we are, not only has Roe been challenged and overturned, but folks are saying, you know, well, maybe we need to look again at gay marriage and a few other things. And it's a kind of a scary time. I think about Shannon, and I remember when I was still at the university that the powers that be, whether it was the counseling department or housing for student housing or what, but that we had at least 6 students enrolled full-time at the university who were living literally in their cars because their parents had kicked them out. And I just could not get my arms around that. I just could not believe it. And that was, you know, after we had already started an LGBT center at the university. And, I think we're at a pivotal point in our lives that we are beginning to realize how precious our rights were and that how easily, one, they can be diluted and or taken away. I had the misfortune in 1972, before Roe versus Wade came into being, and I took 3 dead women my age to the morgue. They had died at the hands of a butcher, dirty abortionist in a motel room in the Poconos. And they all 3 of them died from septic abortions. And I vowed then that I was never going to take dead women to the morgue again. So I'm not quite sure what I'm going to do about that. but I cannot tolerate 10-year-old girls fleeing from rapists to another state to have an abortion. I mean, I really wonder where we are as a society about individuality and respect for people who are different from us. The spate of racist comments that are coming out of people who are running for office now just throws me back, you know, generations. I'm really concerned, not just for the LGBT community, but for anybody who thinks creatively and differently, people who have chosen different lifestyles, people who, you know, are trying to exercise their rights when in fact they may well be taken away. And it's really a very sad time for me. I'm over most of my anger, but I'm really saddened by what I see and hear. And I'm just so glad that Reading has not only an affirmative action plan that they respect and use, but there's an LGBT center now. I remember when there was no such thing. I also remember when we got one of the first AIDS, really it was a hospice house for folks who were dying of AIDS during the early 70s. And by the way, I took care of somebody in the hospital. It was a young gay man. I'm sure he was gay. And I know he died of AIDS before we even had a label to put on that disease. He had every symptom now. And yeah, he, of course, went into isolation because they couldn't figure out what the source of his malady was. And so, you know, I really have to say that, Dr. Amprey says I'm a former nurse. I don't think there is such a thing, Joe. I still wear a watch that has a sweep second hand on it. And one of my professors at my master's in social work program said that I suffered from the dilemma of nursing and social work, that the nurse will not stop until death is imminent or has passed. And the job is to keep working on somebody until we save their life. And then there's social work, so that the end product is what's important in nursing. And in social work, it's the process of getting to the product that's important. And he used to tease me about this dilemma that I had when I was 22 years old, and I'm going to be 77 next year. On my birthday, and I still suffer from the same quandary. Is this a jump on somebody's chest until you've saved them, or is it the process of counseling that we're going to hear about that is important? And so I've never reconciled, and I try not to do that in my own personal life. I was in my early 20s when I finally realized that my difference was because of my sexuality. And I had long since come, like I have with my dilemma about nursing outcomes versus social work outcomes. And I had then long since figured out something was very different with me. And I hadn't really experienced any kind of god-awful experiences that Shannon talked about. You know, I mean, I can't imagine, number one, what it's like to be a woman in the military these days, but to be gay and try to be out or be in your own skin is still, I think, probably not a cakewalk. And so I have always sort of been for the underdog, and that meant myself as well. And so I've had a really wonderful life as a community organizer, doing activism on behalf of people and oppressed folks. I still think seriously about owning a housing rehab business, because the state of housing for low-income people is so terrible. Now we got mortgage rates up that most people can't afford anymore again. And so it's been for me a very constant experience of activism. And I was really pleased that on several occasions, I actually got the head of the transgender national organization to come to Kutztown. She was there several times, both before I retired and after I retired. And so that got us to think about, I think, as a community, who among us was different in that way. And I haven't been to the LGBTQ Center at Kutztown for a while. They've just moved into a new facility and share it with the Women's Center. And because of the impending need to get folks out to vote next month, I'm going to be spending some time at the Boxwood Houses where the whole shoot and match is located. I have mixed feelings about that because it sort of makes me feel like they're isolated as other. And I'm not sure I like the idea, but I think the camaraderie for kids and young people and students who are looking for some stability in their lives, for some answers to their questions, and just for negotiating probably their families. My experience with undergrads was that it was very difficult for them to go home at Thanksgiving and try to explain who they thought they had become, in that quick period of a couple of weeks, their first time away from home. And I think that, I don't know whether the LGBTQ Center is doing any of that counseling at this point or giving folks some ideas about how they could negotiate talking with their parents intelligently and effectively when they first go home at Thanksgiving. My parents finally came to embrace me, and I didn't really care much what they chose to do because I had made my choice, and it fit well, and it served me well, and I just really appreciate all the opportunities I've had. And I really tell you that for me, it's been a very, very rewarding professional career to work with some of the other activists in our community. And I look forward to hearing from our folks at the counseling center with the LGBTQ people. My experience is that I'm very fortunate at my age. There are still a lot of people who have just put their toes out of the closet. And at my age, and it must take a lot of guts to do that. The other thing I want to say to Shannon is that I'm really delighted with your animal therapy stuff, because I had a pony growing up as a kid. I was very fortunate. We had a little Shetland pony, Tony the Pony, and Tony the Pony probably saved my life. I got to be Tonto when I wanted to be Tonto, and I got to be the Lone Ranger when I wanted to be the Lone Ranger, but I had to be Tonto because he was a paint pony, not a silver one. So I had, on Saturday morning when I would go off into the woods and ride Tony the Pony, I had to be, Tonto, because I had the right kind of horse for that. So, I welcome being here. Thanks for having me, Joe. And I'll be quiet because I could take up the whole hour. That former professor never goes away like the nursing thing. Thanks for having me on.
Deb, we need you. Things are getting worse, unfortunately.
They are.
We have more people in office now. Mm-hmm. We've gone backwards. And of course, they overturned Roe v. Wade.
Yep.
And so we've got to continue the battle. We've got to continue to fight because there are people who need us.
Yep, that's for sure.
And there's no greater joy than reaching out and seeing someone overcome some of the obstacles that are just can be overwhelming.
Right.
I'm happy that we have here with the LGBT community here tonight. Michelle Deck had planned to come, and she's not well, but she has Mr. James Wilkie, who's here. This is a source for us. This is an organization that people can reach out to and get help. Mr. Wilkie, take as much time as you'd like and tell us about the Greater Reading LGBT community, who it serves, and how we can get in touch if we need help from them. But again, thank you for coming. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. So for those of you who might not know, the LGBT Center of Greater Reading has been around for quite some time. It was a real grassroots effort That probably started about 10 years ago. What I kind of wanted to comment on today is just where we've come over the past 5 years since Michelle took over as the executive director. I just a little background on me also. I joined the center about 3 years ago as a board member and was so impressed with all of the things that were going on there that I stepped down from the board and joined as the counseling director this week as an employee of the center. The center never started with no employees. It was all volunteers. And Michelle was actually volunteer number one at the center and came on board, as I said, about 5 years ago as employee number one. We have grown from an organization that just provided a safe space for people to congregate and having some support groups and a kitchen where people could come and eat, to an organization that now occupies two floors in a building adjacent to Calvary Church. And we offer free counseling, care coordination, which is helping people with issues around homelessness, food insecurity. We also help people with legal things like name changes if you're a transgender individual. And we also have a fairly large food pantry where people can just walk in off the street and take as much food as they need home with them. Once a month, we also have something called Warm Meal Wednesdays, where we reach out to the entire community. And we probably feed about 90 people a month, both people who come into Calvary to eat with us, but more so we have a van and we'll drive out into the community and distribute hot meals to probably about 60 people. In addition to that, we have some thriving support groups. There are two different types of support groups. There are counselor facilitator-led groups and other activity groups. And we'll talk a little bit about the support groups that are either facilitator or counselor-led. Probably our most successful support group to date is the Voices group, which is our youth group. And it serves kids ages 10 to 17 or 18 if you're still in high school. And it's a program where people can come in and, you know, we'll offer different types of programming. Some of it is art, some of it's cooking, just different things where people can express themselves. And that's a very successful program. We have a program that people can graduate into after that, called Share the Pride, which is doing phenomenally well right now. It's comprised mostly of younger people in their 20s and 30s who are going through some kind of transition in life. So it might be coming out to parents, coming out as transgender, going through that transition process, finding jobs, just basically coming into their own. That kind of sex self-actualization moment in people's lives is much more complicated when you have that LGBT layer onto it. You know, it's hard enough for, you know, anybody to become an adult without having to face a lot of other obstacles. And we try to help people through that with our programs. That's kind of the support aspect of it. We also do a lot of training and advocacy. So we meet with a lot of organizations, both profit and nonprofit organizations, and train them on various levels of LGBT competency. We actually just hosted an event called Out in the Park with about 100 merchants, and some of them have been through our training, and it's been fairly successful. We probably trained over 800 people in the community year to date at about 45 facilities, we're very happy about that, and people have filled out surveys at the end of the training, say that their awareness of the community and their ability to serve people in the community has increased significantly after going through our training. So that made us very happy. Those are pretty much the, we do a lot of community outreach also. We have many events throughout the year. We've probably touched about 4,500 people in the community through those events this year. Overall, since Michelle's taken the reins about 5 years ago, the center has just exploded. We've gotten so much bigger. There's also more awareness that we're around. So as a result of that, our institutional and individual donor base has increased, which allows us to launch a lot of these new programs. So that's kind of the overview of what we do. I don't know if you had any specific questions. But
please give us some phone numbers and email addresses if people want to contact you.
Okay. So they can actually contact me at the LGBT Center, and the email address is lgbtcenterofreadingcounseling@gmail.com. And I never remember our own phone number, so I need to look that up. The phone number we could be reached at is 484-513-3170. Again, that's 484-513-3170. And our hours are 10 in the morning to 8 o'clock at night, Monday through Thursday. And that's the other thing I didn't mention. We also have a drop-in center. So people are encouraged to come by if they just need a place to be. A lot of people who are having trouble at home or, you know, are dealing with some temporary homeless situations will come during the day. We have Wi-Fi. They can apply for jobs. They can hang out and meet other people. But it just provides a safe space for, you know, people in the community. And it also answers another need, which I didn't mention, which is why a lot of people come to support groups. There's a lot of isolation in the community. Especially right now in the transgender community. Mm-hmm. So this is an opportunity for people to kind of see each other and know that they're not alone. And there are other people who are going through the types of things that they're going through. Because when they're kind of out and about, a lot of people are still closeted and they don't have a chance to make those connections.
Well, thank you so much for what you're doing, and especially for coming on tonight. You were not, you didn't know about this until about 5 o'clock today.
And yeah, how was I?
Matter of fact, you were great.
She's going to ask you, and then you agreed to come on. This is last minute. You've had a long day.
Yeah, but you know, I love what I do, so it's okay. And you know, it's easy to talk about a place that you really care about a lot.
Well, what you're doing
is nice to have a job where I feel like we're making a difference.
Well, you are, and it's so important. And again, I most appreciate the fact that you come on the last minute like this. It's so important. Shannon, you live in the Pottstown area, and I feel
I live in Fleetwood.
Oh, you've moved. Good.
Yeah, good.
I worry about, of course, now you can't help me with Pottstown now because you're in Fleetwood, but I always worried about what we can do in Montgomery County, what we can do in Schuylkill County. And I did make a contact at Schuylkill, and they're going to try to be on next year. But Reading, of course, is central to a lot of this, but there are people who aren't as close. So were you able to make any contacts when you were in the Pottstown area? Any source of support you could recommend to us?
So when I was kicked out at 15, I basically moved in with my sister, and then something occurred there after a day, and she didn't really want a gay guy living with her and her son. So I moved out and slept on a park bench for a while.
I mean, the thing you've
I didn't really have any support other than my one brother, Johnny. He, you know, he stepped up, he helped out. Other than that, like counseling services, it was mainly where I could get them at school. It was like high school I was going to. And even then I had to eventually drop out because the commute was way too far. So I actually went online, and there's actually online resources that were very, very slim to none back then. But nowadays you can go online and find a talk therapist where you can either Zoom them, you can meet face to face, or you can actually just have a call or text. There's a lot of them popping up now, which is honestly, I think it's an advent from, sad to say, but the epidemic that just recently happened, where everybody got sent home and then everyone had to work from home. I think that was pretty good because it raised our networking infrastructure to a point where we can actually do these things. Like right now, I'm at my place of work, you know, talking to you guys through Zoom. And if it wasn't for, you know, the advent of technology, I don't think people would be able to have a lot of help out there.
Well, technology is phenomenal now. Zoom especially, and people can, we have virtual everything now. And yeah. So now one thing that's really happened recently, which I am so sorry that we had COVID, but COVID has really given power to mental health, that for so many years, people were ashamed to ask for help, mental health especially. But COVID has isolated people in such a way that we're now seeing a real kick in the pants or shot in the arm for psychiatrists, clinical psychologists, for the whole mental health community. So while COVID is something I hope we can get over, I'm sorry it occurred, it has helped the mental health community tremendously. And
I think that's in part because, I know, at least for me, being a male growing up in the household that I did, where, you know, manhood was something that was forced, like you have to be masculine, you have to, you know, come home with dirty hands. I think that having that mask of an internet basically helps, you know, those that are scared because they were conditioned to not ask for help. And I mean, when I was growing up, it was basically, you need help, don't ask your father. Your father's just going to tell you to go do it yourself. You learn, you mess up, then he yells at you or he hits you. But, you know, counseling services have come leaps and bounds since I was a kid, and I'm only 35.
Well, I think one of the unfortunate things in our society is that too many men are not allowed to be sensitive or to show weakness. And I must admit, while I'm a psychologist, I've been trained in therapy, I still have trouble crying in public. And I know that tears are good. There's therapy in crying. And I do it alone, but I still need to grow in terms of not being ashamed. You know, I'm at a graduation, and I'm seeing kids graduating, and I'm happy. Tears are coming, and I'm trying to hide them. And I know it's wrong, but that is something I've had to work on. To really learn that it's okay to ask for help. It's okay to be weak. It's okay to be sensitive. And so we all, you know, and I think that in some ways our women handle these kind of things better than men do. You know, you can get together and cry about something and get it out. And we have so many cases of people who suffer because they kept things pent up inside. The feelings were not expressed. So I think that
I did that for 7 years of my life.
And of course,
when I went through my heroin addiction.
Yeah, and of course, so much of addiction is really a way of coping, but again, watching you grow and get a degree and work on a second degree, and then reach out has really made me feel good, and so I'm so proud of you and what you're doing and what you've overcome. So keep on doing what you're doing, brother.
Thank you. I just hope that if anyone walks away from this service tonight with one thing in mind, I just want them to know that, like, what homelessness taught me was that I can overcome anything the world has to throw at me. Anything. And I mean that.
So it actually made you stronger.
Mm-hmm.
Which is what?
Yes.
Yeah. Things are we're going backwards in many ways, but we've got to dig in and continue to battle. We have to continue to step out and do what we have to do.
It just doesn't stop when a law is passed. Like, take Roe versus Wade, for instance. Roe versus Wade was passed, and now it's taken away. It's very easy to have rights just taken from individuals when they don't have a voice of their own to speak. And I fear we've gotten too complacent as a community. Well, not just our community, every community.
Yeah, I teach a class now, and I remind my students that even though their greatest goal is, in most cases, are to get as high a grade as possible, my goal for them is to know and love who they are, to feel good about who they are. I love that statement made by Eleanor Roosevelt many years ago that no one can lower your self-esteem. You know, you are in control. And I think that's so important. And I also I'm emphatic with the fact that you have to love yourself. And that is not arrogance. People who love themselves can be comfortable, can be humble for that matter, because they can reach out. But you got to start with self, and there has to be self-love. And some too often it's seen as an arrogance, but really the people who really have it together are not arrogant at all. Arrogance is usually a cover-up. Usually the guy who's telling you how great he is, deep down inside, is suffering. And one of the mistakes we make as teachers, as therapists, is that oftentimes we look at the outer shell and make assumptions based on that. And so often I've been wrong because I saw this strong outer shell and I didn't reach out for the inner shell that needed help, because I assumed erroneously that the outer shell was stronger than it really was. But that's so important. And thank God for people like Dr. Deborah Sieger. Thank God for the LGBT community. People like Michelle Deck. And, of course, Mr. James Wilkie. You guys are making a phenomenal contribution. But we've got to keep on going, because it's getting more challenging now. Mm-hmm. And that should make us redouble our efforts to step forward for people who really need our help and our support. It's so important. All of you have already made great contributions, and I want to remind you that this program will be rebroadcast at 10 a.m. on Wednesday, 3 p.m. on Friday, and noon on Sunday. So if you have anybody who thinks can benefit from this, they can reach out and see it at those times. That's BCTV Channel 15, and it's a local station here which has a lot. This is just one of many, many programs. And I've been so involved with Zoom that it wasn't until a few weeks ago that I went to the studio. The studio that there now is just fantastic. I was really impressed. And I have to really thank Mr. Lojack, the president of Alverna University. For many years, BCTV was located on the campus of Albury College. But now it's part of the town center of Alverna University at 4th and Penn downtown. And that building is, I've got to go there for a meeting next week, and I'm looking forward to it because they're doing phenomenal things. But the three of you, is there anything that I've left out that you think needs to be said on behalf of our LGBT community? Anybody have anything you want to say before I start rambling again? Because I have a few things I'm going to say, but I'm give you guys get a chance to get a word in edgewise. Anything that you want to say that you haven't said already?
Well, I just think that, you know, little old Redding should be a little boastful about some of the things. It's a hidden gem, and lots of people don't think too much of it. But for us to have an LGBT center, for to have Berks Community Television like this, I mean, this is truly a wonderful ability to make known the phone number and the address where you can reach services. And to have people like you, Joe, who are willing and able to open up their heads a bit and expand their experiences and their interviewing. And I sometimes just am overwhelmed by the good things in this little gem called Reading, Pennsylvania, because we not only have a strong Pennsylvania German history, that we don't run away from. My grandparents did hide their German roller music for the piano during World War II, but then when the Nazis had been overcome, they got it back out again. And we've got everything from that to an LGBT center that's just blossomed in no time flat, basically. I mean, a decade to have, you know, a program like that that's available and then put it on TV and have BCTV willing to sponsor something like this is really pretty important. And it's especially, as you say, Joe, now more than ever, we got to dig in and start all over again. Just keep fighting. Because it's truly important. There are, you know, I've watched too many people, you know, either go to drugs and alcohol as a way of coping, or severe mental illnesses, or just, you know, when we were just starting with some, you know, of the older generation of gay people, mostly men who were having a lot of difficulty stepping out and to see the pain that they were in. Because of lack of support and, you know, social acceptance, it was like just truly feeling a waste of a lifetime. And slowly but surely, they were crawling out from under the rug or out of the clamshell. And it's because of the services that are available that they felt a little comfortable. And quite frankly, I think that society in general is far more accepting of lesbians than gay men. And I think that as I listen to people saying, is that a trans person? What, you know, they're curious beyond belief, but not always endorsing. But more and more because of some parents who have been really, really helpful with their children and very open and accepting. I was listening to a program on public radio today about the evolution of services to autistic children and how that whole field of intervention has changed so dramatically over the years, from a kind of a corporal program to one where families are really strong advocates for their children. So I think there are some really good things adjacent to the LGBTQ community. But I still think there's a lot of fear still about transgender folk. Most people don't understand a thing about it. And I just think that my experience has been so, so poignant with trans people. At first, I was really angry that they had to go to counseling for I don't know how many years before they could transition and have the surgical changes and stuff. And I was really angry about that. And then I began to work with a statewide organization working for LGBTQ rights. And I got to know a bunch of trans people. And I think what I figured out was that the counseling that was required of them was really effective and helpful because they were able to assert themselves in ways that I was not familiar with. And a kind of a whole new gay pride was just evolving from that. And those were people who were really in touch with themselves. And I had to step back and say, get rid of your prejudice about this requirement for the counseling. It seems to be working. And maybe if the rest of us in society went to some of that counseling, it would be a better place. So, you know, I just would say to the trans community, just hang in there, folks, because I think a lot of folks are curious, not just put off or off put. By trans people. I think they just don't understand. Yeah. There's just a heck of a lot of ignorance out there around it. And I think about gay people too. I mean, we get up in the morning, we go to the bathroom, we take showers, we eat breakfast, you know? Yeah. And any of you guys out there listening who have ever really respected your grandfather or your uncle or your great uncle, you know, that's a kind of a love. It may not be sex, but it's a kind of love that is between same gendered people. And if we can stop and think about that and think about the relationships we've had that are so fruitful, where people can really begin to be honest with each other, that's a beautiful gift. And I just would like to say that for the listening audience, stop by the center. You'll find that the doors are open. The folks are willing to talk. They're willing to listen. and it can just be a hell of a lot of fun.
And it doesn't even matter if they're gay. They can come and stop by the center if they're straight.
Exactly. Good point. Excellent point. Yep.
And in fact, I think that's a great idea, because I think most of the people who discriminate against the community don't think they know anyone in the community.
Exactly.
You know, once people meet somebody or they realize they have a friend who's gay or transgender, a lot of people come around.
So their worldview starts to change.
Yeah, and, it's true.
I like what you said about transgender people, because almost half of the people that we see for counseling right now are transgender. And I kind of feel like transgender people are where gay people were 20 or 30 years ago.
Yeah.
Just in terms of how receptive the community at large is to that population.
Yeah.
So often we've taken weaknesses and made them strengths. For example, imagine that during World War II, Hitler annihilated more than 6 million Jews. And now look at how powerful our Jewish community is. Mm-hmm. There's still anti-Semitism, but mm-hmm. they dominate higher education,
yep.
the arts, yep. And music.
Philanthropy.
Yes. Yep. 30 years ago, we thought that if you had the gay disease, we called it, you were going to die.
AIDS,
AIDS. But now, what happened was, more often there were heterosexuals who were infected more so than gay. The gay community got mm-hmm. together on that, so it doesn't happen. Yeah. And they've become stronger. And I've met so many people who were hiding in the closet, and they come out and become very strong. One of my favorite people on TV now is Don Lemon, who came out and has become a superstar. He's a gay man. And of course, on the other station, MSNCTV, there's a gay lady who is the most powerful spokesperson there. So we can turn our weaknesses into strengths, or our oppression into strengths. And as I said earlier, we need more now than ever before. Just out of to be educational about this, gender is male or female, but how we react to that becomes sexual orientation. So that we have macho guys, we have sensitive guys who are artistic. We have gay guys, we have gay women. And I had an experience years ago where I was teaching a class on family therapy, and we invited people to bring in people whose lifestyle were different. I had a lesbian come in, and she told us that she thought that her parents thought that when she met the right guy, she would become straight. she felt that they were not threatened by her. She felt that our society is more threatened by gay men.
I think so too.
Than by gay women, for that reason.
I would agree with that.
She says, "We're so prejudiced to think that the male role is the preferred role, that it's okay for a person, and they think that a gay woman wants to be a male. It's going to be male, and that's where there's so much ignorance around this area about what their preferred roles are, whose roles is what, and so I think." Going into a center and talking to people and asking questions. If you go in there, they know you're not threatened. And we need to get rid of our ignorances. We need to talk to people, understand each other, and get along better. But we have to understand that biologically we're male or female, but we can take all kinds of directions in that. We can be a male who wants to become a female, or vice versa. And we can be a male attracted to males. And not all gay men are effeminate. There are a whole lot of macho guys.
I don't think I'm very effeminate, but
I've never thought you were. But
you're a horseman.
But you were in the Navy. You had a chance to look at all kinds of reactions and guys and people. But you've overcome very so true. Much. You've overcome so much, and I'm proud of you for that, Jan. And and you're about to finish KU. And you're going to be doing
therapy. Two more years.
You're going to be doing drug therapy, aren't you, in terms of...
addiction counseling.
Yeah. Well, I once had a student...
Hopefully, my main goal is to turn it from addiction counseling to equine therapy, where, you have horses that help the person in dire need of help with, maintenance and just getting back involved into having something to care about. It's mainly for hope. Like, there was great. This one, our one instructor just had us go through, we're learning about Yom and all of his therapy.
Uh-huh.
Yes. No, Yom.
Okay. Okay. Is that you took Y-U-M.
Y-A-L-O-M.
Okay.
And we had to learn about his processes of group therapy and the 11 kind of like steps, but there was one with hope, turning from hopelessness to hope. And that's basically what therapy is. You know, we're giving hope back to the person who feels hopeless.
Well, that's so important. And the other thing is that we've got to get people to think it, believe it's okay to get therapy. Too many men don't want therapy and could use it. And and it's okay to seek help and to get therapy. We have to get people to understand that and to reach inside and find their inner strength. That's so important. I don't think we should end without having Mr. Wilkie give us again the numbers, the phone numbers, and email addresses for the Greater Reading LGBT community.
Okay. The phone number again is 484-513-3170. One of the things I neglected to say is that we also have a couple of satellite offices. We just opened another location in Pottstown. So you can call that number and find out a little bit more about the programming we're offering down there. We're not down there every day, but we're usually down there on Wednesdays. And we're in the process of opening up another satellite in Lancaster County in Columbia.
Wow.
So the best thing to do is just call the number and we can tell you a little bit more about the services we have to offer and what services might be good for you.
Let me tell our viewing audience also that I always do this program on the second Monday of the month. And in November, I will be reaching out to the community that has physical differences. That community has been neglected also. And of course, we will be reaching out. So if you have anybody who has what we call a physical challenge, who'd like to talk about it and have them get in touch with me. Before the show goes off, you'll see my email address and phone numbers there, because that will be our program for the second month in the second Monday in November. Again, I want to thank Mr. James Wilkie for coming on at the last minute. Dr. Deborah Sieger, Shannon Hoehne, all of you have made phenomenal contributions, and I really appreciate what you're doing. We have to really teach our community to accept all people, that it's okay to be gay. It's okay to have transgender, to have a person to be a transgender person. It's okay to not know and get help in these areas. And most importantly, we don't choose our sexual orientation. We're born that way for most of us. And many people who are homophobic think it's a choice. It's not a choice. And we cannot condemn people for wanting to live their lives the way they were born to live them. Again, thank my all three of my guests for coming on. Ms. Freeman, thank you for all you and the people at BCTV do to make this a possibility. And I'll remind those who are watching, if you want to encourage people to watch, we'll on again at 10 a.m. on Wednesday, 3 p.m. on Friday, and then on Sunday. Thank you very much. Good night. God bless.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Diversity, the wider vision on BCTV is supported by Berks Community Action Program.